Greetings, everybody. I hope you're doing well. We're going to be doing something a little bit different this year. So this year, we're going to be trying video. So I do some explainer videos going through portfolio management stuff. I share my screen. We're going to be doing something similar with some year-end commentary. It's going to be heavy on graphs. This isn't a prediction piece. We have no opinion about what happens next. Forecasting, as we've outlined, in a normal environment is extremely difficult. In a global pandemic, it is a fool's errand to undertake, in our opinion. So this is going to be some thought-provoking stuff, things of interest, some metrics that we're watching. We're heavy on evidence. We're heavy on taking our cues from the market rather than what Wall Street says or what an analyst says or even our personal opinions about what we think. We are heavy on how investors vote with their capital and how that's reflected in bond prices, equity positioning, so on and so forth. So let's get into it. So we really pay attention to what small business owners say. In our opinion, they're the backbone of the US economy. And to no one's surprise, the most important problems per small business owners is cost of labor, quality of labor, and inflation. And the cost of labor and inflation are linked. And you can see on this chart, percentile of all periods, and this goes back 80 something years or since inception of this survey, we are in the extreme outlier readings, the highest percentile pretty much across the board for the month of November. Like this one, the quality of labor is never been a bigger problem for small business owners. And you can see inflation is right there and the cost of labor is right there as well. So again, this is just something to keep in mind. This is not a secret. But we really do pay attention because small business has a huge input on the GDP of this country. And continuing on the inflation theme, so a few weeks ago, it might have been a few months ago, I outlined what asset classes hold up well in a inflationary environment. And what we're looking at here is the S&P is this darker blue line, and this starts at the start of 2021. Overlaid with the CPI, which is just a basket of consumer goods and services. And to no one's surprise, inflation has been a problem that's been getting worse as we move through the year. But you can also see how stocks, and this is again the S&P, this dark blue line, stocks are historically a really good hedge for inflation. And I think you can see that clearly here. And the reason why I bring this up, because we talk to a lot of people, and inflation is at the top of their worry list. And the way they manifest that outlook is by selling all of their stocks and parking money in cash. Empirical evidence would suggest that cash is the worst thing to own in a inflationary environment because you're not getting a return and the cost of goods and services are rising. So you're actually losing purchasing power. So how you express your inflationary view is extremely important. And again, empirical evidence would suggest that stocks are a pretty good place to be if inflation is a problem. Now, this chart is probably the biggest issue for the inflation is a long-term problem crowd. Now, just to be clear, inflation is here, it's a problem. The argument is it a long-term problem or is it a short-term problem coming off a pandemic, still in the midst of a pandemic? That's the question everybody is asking, including the Fed. No one really knows, but again, in the spirit of taking our cues from financial markets, and you can argue the bond markets are the smartest capital on planet Earth, the bond market is saying inflation is not a long-term, okay? So when I look at this, again, the CPI starting at the beginning of 2021, trending to the right and trending higher, look at where the 10-year yield was, and that's the dark blue line, at the start of, let's call it April, okay? It's actually higher in April of 2021 than it is today, and this chart was as of the end of the first week of December, so this is pretty current. Inflation was higher 8 months ago than it was today, despite CPI inflation going much higher. So you can see if I was to draw a line from this point to this point, inflation has exploded higher. The 10-year yield has actually gone low. So that to me indicates that the bond market believes inflation is not a long-term problem. It believes it's a temporary problem. Now, you can make the opposite case, you could make a logical argument that that is not playing out in the real economy. But again, like I mentioned, inflation's here. The question is it a long-term problem? Just to give you a frame of reference, back in 1982, we had similar inflation numbers as we have today. The 10-year yield was around 12 or 13%. So similar inflation numbers today, bond market telling completely different stories. And know that bond markets, financial markets, stock markets are all forward-looking. So yeah, they care about what happens now, but they're trying to project based on what they think is going to happen in 3 months, 6 months, and a year. So this is an interesting chart. This is probably the most controversial chart of 2021 between the inflation is a long-term problem crowd and the inflation is transitory. I hate to use that word, but a short-term problem. Sticking on the inflation theme, so it's a widely accepted view that commodities are historically an inflation hedge. Now, not all commodities are the same. There's agriculture commodities, there's precious metals. And some of the factors at play that drive agriculture prices are different than precious metals. And the most obvious one is weather. So I want you to pay less attention to some of these agriculture-based commodities because they can be influenced by where these commodities are grown and harvested, weather, things that are really random or at least can move in more violent extremes. Precious metals is where I want you to focus on. And this has been a rough year for precious metals, including gold. And gold historically has been thought of as an inflation hedge. Kind of in the spirit of what the bond markets are saying about inflation, gold's really not signaling inflation is going to be a long-term problem. Rewind to last year in 2020. Gold was up roughly 25%. That was gold looking ahead and saying inflation is going to be maybe a 2021 problem. And its upward price movement reflected that view. This to me, if we're looking through that same lens, and again, we could be wrong, gold, silver, platinum, all of these things are looking forward and saying, maybe inflation will not be a long-term problem. In our last slide on the inflation front, so there is signs that a lot of these supply chain issues, which directly affect prices for consumer goods and services, goods really, are starting to dissipate. And I didn't want to beat a dead horse here, but this is one of the biggest piers, I think the biggest ports, excuse me, on the West Coast. And you can see the Long Beach vessels at sea, or excuse me, vessels at anchor. So waiting to port, waiting to unload their goods, really spiked here at the end of summer and throughout the fall is really starting to dissipate. So that logjam is starting to go away, which helps the flow of goods, really helps with transportation times. It helps reduce supply chain log jams. So this is an encouraging sign. And this is happening not just in Long Beach, but across the globe. So, you know, for those folks that are predicting that inflation is going to be transitory or short term, this is a good sign. So there's been a lot of talk about the Fed taper, the pace of the taper. Are they going to get more aggressive? Are they going to stick to their current plan? And I just want to use this historical hiking announcement and completion of the taper as a frame of reference. So this is back in 2013 to 2014. And this is the last time the Fed announced a taper and ended up hiking rates. So this isn't gospel. This is not how this cycle is going to go. But I think it's important to look at recent history to understand how some of these cycles work. So this first blue circle is when the Fed announced the taper, okay? And a taper just means the Fed is starting the process to normalize interest rates. So first they have to reduce and eventually stop buying bonds, which helps keep rates low. Then they have to raise rates. So that's kind of the logistics of how this works. And this line here is the S&P 500, okay? So you can see when the Fed announced the taper back in, let's call it June, July of 2013, there was some noise in stock prices. So you can see this dip and then this rise and then this dip and then this rise and then another dip. So there is some noise around that announcement. And as we continue with the tapering cycle, so the Fed is reducing their bond purchases over time, and it lasted a little over a year. This is when they completed their bond purchase cycle. In other words, they stopped purchasing bonds, okay? Announced. And this circle is stop purchasing bonds. And you can see when they stopped, there was also some noise around stock prices. Okay, so let's keep that in mind as we look to the next slide. So taper complete, Now we're going to go into the actual interest rate increase cycle. So from December of 2015, right here, to December of 2018, the Federal Reserve increased interest rates 9 times. All right. So over the course of a three-year period, they increased interest rates 9 times. And there's a couple things here. There's kind of this narrative that higher interest rates are bad for stock prices. Again, this is the S&P, and you can see during this particular cycle, again, not saying this is going to happen next time, stock prices did okay. They did better than okay. They had a pretty good run. The third thing that I want you to take from this is the Fed, if you remember, was pretty much on autopilot during this cycle. And they hiked 9 times, and they had plans to hike a few more times. And they basically said, no matter what happens in the economy, no matter what happens in financial markets, we're setting our watch to this, and we're going to hike to get rates to X percent. So they had this rate target, and they were going to get there come hell or high water. The market said things are starting to soften. The real economy is starting to roll over. Stock prices are starting to flatline a bit. They're starting to be cracks in the economic outlook and forecast. And the financial markets had the worst, or the S&P, I should say, had the worst fourth quarter, or one of the worst in history, and dropped almost 20%. The Fed reversed course, said, okay, we're not only going to stop increasing rates, but we're going to start cutting. We're going to start a fresh interest rate reduction cycle. So the message here is there's this idea that the Fed is the setter of economic and monetary policy, and they're very much a leader about what happens next in both the economy and financial markets. This tells me they're very much a follower. And you can argue about if that was the intention of the Fed. It probably wasn't. They have more influence over equity market prices than perhaps they ever have in history. But when the markets want something, the Fed tends to fall in line. Okay. So while there's a lot of conversation around the Fed, what they do next, investors, capital flows, large institutions are still very much in charge here. So the Fed is a reactionary force rather than a proactive force. Okay, switching to stock prices and trying to get a sense around future returns. There's been a lot of talk about what stock prices do next. There's almost a consensus that current levels are not sustainable and that we're due for a pullback. I wrote a post a few months back about the best predictor of future stock prices, and it's actually amazingly simple, and it stood the test of time over the past 80 plus years. And that is the higher the household equity ownership percentage. So in other words, the more households like you and me own equities, the greater percentage of households owning equities, the lower future stock price returns. And let me show you what this looks like. So this goes back to 1987, okay? And you know, we're following the light blue line, which is household direct and indirect equity allocation percentage of financial assets. And this is just household direct, indirect equity allocation percentage of all assets. So this is the percentage of investable assets that you have in equities. That's the light blue line, and the percentage of your overall assets. So including your house, your car, all of your other assets, your percentage of equity ownership for a broader based asset side of your balance sheet. But they basically say the same thing. As we reach these ownership peaks, as households crowd into equities and own a large percentage of their household balance sheet and investable assets into equities, the lower the future returns are. Okay. So we mark this in this particular graph with these dark gray areas, which show recessions. So you'll notice these peaks preempt recessions, which are the dark gray. These peaks back in 2008, back in 2001, preempt a recession. It was the same as we headed into COVID, right? Equity ownership was at the cycle peak, and we had a recession. Now we've hit a new equity allocation percentage of assets and investable assets. So history would tell us that would preempt a recession and likely a lower future stock prices. Sorry, some of this can get rather confusing. I'm trying to explain it multiple times so point gets driven home. So I apologize if I'm repeating myself. This is just another way to look at it. So this is 10-year annualized returns for the S&P from April 1979. So going forward 10 years, and we're comparing 10-year future returns with how much households own in equities. Okay. And there's a theme here. So I don't want you to pay attention to any of this nonsense, but this is where we were as far as equity percentage ownership in the fourth quarter of 2020, 48%. Okay. So this star here, based on history from 1979 to the present, and I think this cuts off at December of 2020, future returns at these equity ownership levels are basically nothing, right? So this left axis here shows the return. And as we go out to the right, that shows equity percentage ownership. So as we get out here, future returns tend to drop. 10-year future returns tend to be negative. So this doesn't bode well for future stock returns based on history. Of course, this cycle could be different, but we're a fan of evidence, and the evidence is not on the side of folks that think this bull run is going to continue uninterrupted. This is just another look here, equity stock allocation percentage rank. This is by percentile. So as we get into these highest percentiles, which we are right now, I think we're in the 90th percentile. You can see that 2-year future returns for the S&P are negative, 5-year future returns for the S&P are negative, and so are 10-year future returns for the S&P negative. Now, on the flip side, when investors hate equities, you can see future returns are through the roof. So when equities are out of favor and ownership percentages are in the lowest percentiles, you can see the 10-year future returns are much, much higher. Okay. Now, this is a perfect segue into my next slide. So despite the evidence to suggest that future returns are going to be lower based on our starting point, that doesn't jive with investor return expectations. And this can be summed up nothing short of delusion. And I only included this chart, but it's even worse among younger people. And if you think about it, if you started your career, like if you graduated college in 2010, you really haven't seen any pain in financial markets. You've only known basically a decade of uninterrupted gains for not only stock prices, but for digital assets like Bitcoin, home prices. I mean, it's been really hard to miss. And I always say a lot of geniuses are created during up markets. It hides a lot of warts. And my fear is we've created this cohort, this generation of investors that has never seen pain. And it's easy to be a risk-seeking investor when times are good. It's much more difficult when times are tough. And back when I graduated from college, which was 2004, that was in the midst of the lost decade. So from 2000 to 2010, US large cap stock prices basically were down. So if you parked 100 grand into the S&P in January of 2000, and you fast forward 10 years, you would have lost money, which does help you appreciate risk. There was a great recession in there. You know, a lot of people were upside down on their mortgage, lost their job. So that does affect your ability and tolerance to take on risk. And then, as I said, there's a generation that really hasn't felt that. So that shows up in these numbers where their return expectations are completely unhinged with reality. And you can see this just keeps creeping higher as equity prices continue to ascend higher. So there's a behavioral component to this where humans tend to overweight what just happened. So there's a recency bias. If stock prices were good last year, then they're probably going to be good next year. And again, that really shows up in these numbers. So this is an interesting chart, and I apologize, it's kind of blurry. So what I want to show here is where we were pre-COVID, right? The pre-COVID high, which is this gray line here. We had the COVID low, and then basically we've just ascended higher from there. I mean, almost in a parabolic fashion. And this is where we're currently at. A 10% correction would put us put us here. So back where we were in, you know, maybe summer, a bear market, which is a 20% correction, would put us still above the pre-COVID high, but maybe where we were at heading into 2020, so December of 2019. And why I say this and why I bring this up, because there's a contingent of folks that really don't understand this move higher, especially when you reconcile what's going on in the real economy with inflation, with the labor markets. It really has become disjointed between financial market prices, stock prices, and what's going on in the real economy. You have this faction of folks that want to make these large active decisions and go to all cash. And they're continuing to be either in all cash or much more conservative than they would normally be. But then this happens and you're just left in a horrible spot. And it's been said oftentimes preparing for a correction by going to all cash can be more penalizing than the correction itself. And I think that's really manifested here. Meaning, you know, if you just plugged your cash in or stayed invested, then you've enjoyed this. And even if you get the correction that you fear is going to happen, you're still going to be much better off than if you're just sitting in cash, not earning anything. Inflation is eating away at your purchasing power. So, you know, there is an extreme penalty for making these large allocation shifts. And I think this is just a nice graph for context. And kind of in the spirit of things, and I don't want to be a cheerleader here, but kind of in that same vein, a lot of people agonized over entry points. Like if you're sitting in all cash, when should I get fully invested? And look, there is noise in the short term. So if you're about to retire, if you're newly retired, yeah, you can smooth out some of the noise in financial markets by layering in cash over time. But as you extend your time frame, as you go out 10 years, there's a 94% chance over a rolling 10-year period, any rolling 10-year period over the last 100 years, that the S&P 500 is going to be positive. So that U.S. large cap stocks are going to be positive, right? So when I hear young people agonizing about, oh, I've got cash, I don't need it, I'm a long-term investor, but I'm going to wait because I think a pullback's coming. Empirical evidence is not on your side. You would be better off plugging in that cash and going on about your day. So, you know, what this tells me is history's not riddled with folks that are betting against American companies and the American economy. Sure, if you're about to retire, you know, you can use a more measured approach, but still there's a strong likelihood stocks are going to be higher over any period of time. So really don't stress and agonize over the decision on when to put cash to work. Okay. So a couple of weeks ago, I wrote about being at all-time highs from real estate to cryptocurrency to stocks, yet everyone seems miserable. And I go into reasons why I think that. I'm not going to get into that here. But sentiment is one of the things that we watch really closely, because people forget, you know, markets are complex systems, but at the end of the day, it's humans interacting with other humans. And humans are irrational in very predictable ways. And I think this really shows itself when you look at sentiment. So how people are feeling about financial market prospects, about future stock returns. And time and again, the worse people feel about future stock returns, the better stock returns are. The better people feel about future stock returns, the worse returns are. So this to me is not excessive. Yeah, the markets are higher. Markets have had another really good year, but investor sentiment is about average, right? If you were to draw a line through this chart going back to 2006, I mean, it's neither optimistic or pessimistic. So I would classify this as neutral sentiment, which is perhaps the most bullish case that I've heard for the future prospects of stocks. If people aren't feeling so hot, that tends to be good for future stock prices. You know, I say on the opposite end of that, as soon as your Uber driver starts telling you that tech stocks can only go up and he's just making money hand over fist, that's more likely to mark a market top than something like this. I'm not going to turn this into a hot COVID conversation, but we would be doing our clients a disservice if we didn't pay attention to COVID trends. And it's not like we're getting our COVID news from mainstream media. That's hardly the case, but we really monitor Google search trends, because they tend to lead future COVID cases. And I'll show you an example of this. So on the top, we're tracking Google search trends for the reopening index. So think about people moving out and about, getting on with their lives. And you can see what that entails. So when people Google these various terms, which correlate with getting out and doing stuff, then we aggregate those and we can show that when people are feeling nervous about COVID and not moving out and about, you can see these trends, which are marked by the blue line. So these are the Google search trends for these terms. When these go down, future case counts tend to be higher, and that makes sense. If people are scared to go out, we can expect future case trends to go higher. Conversely, when people are confident in searching for some of these things, going out to dinner, going to a movie, going on a cruise, case counts tend to be lower. So again, it's not like we're making investment decisions and predicting where things go from here, but there's various themes going on. The kind of old economy stocks, which benefit from people getting out and about, going to work, getting dressed up for work, putting gas in their tank, going to a movie, going to a restaurant, that's one tailwind. And then there's the work from home kind of hunker down COVID index, which we track these things, right? Microphone, mouse, Zoom, work from home. And as these things, the work from home trends, as people search for these things less, case counts go up, right? Because they're out and about and they're doing stuff. When people are looking to not work from home, that leads to higher case counts, right? And people, when they're looking to work from home, that leads to lower case counts. So know that Google Trends can give us insight about future COVID case counts. Okay, let's talk about PE ratios, our starting points for various indexes. And make no mistake, there's been some noise in financial markets the last couple months. But back to my previous blog post, this has been a pretty serene year, a docile year for stocks, where basically nothing happened but stock prices going up. September, October hit, things got a little hairy, and things are continuing to be a little sideways in November and December. The equity asset classes that have taken the worst of it have been U.S. mid-cap, U.S. small-cap, emerging markets, and foreign stocks. And that's outlined by these. So the blue line is mid-cap, green line is small-cap, red is a foreign stock index, and then the gray is emerging markets. So those P.E. ratios have gone down, and P.E. is price divided by earnings. So price has gone down, which means those markets have gotten a bit cheaper. What hasn't really gotten cheaper is U.S. large cap stocks. So the valuation opportunity set, for lack of a better term, has gotten more attractive for some of these other equity asset classes and less attractive on the U.S. large cap front. So U.S. large caps still are very much expensive by historical standards and relative to some of these other equity asset classes. And this next chart is pretty cool. So again, we're looking at the blue is the S&P large caps, orange is mid caps, gray small cap, yellow is emerging markets, and I guess this lighter blue color is foreign equities. Okay, so these are forward PE ratios, estimated PE ratios from 10 years ago for the various equity asset classes. Okay, so looking at this 10 years ago, by future PE or forward PE, the most expensive market was U.S. small cap. The next most expensive was mid cap, followed by U.S. large cap. But all of these are pretty much in line. Okay, fast forward 10 years, the valuation gap between U.S. large cap now versus 10 years ago is very wide. It's much less wide. It's more narrow. It's almost at parity with small caps now. In 10 years, is a little bit higher now, and that makes sense because, you know, although mid caps and small caps and emerging markets and foreign stocks have lagged U.S. large caps, they've been positive over the last 10 years. But this gap here is probably unsustainable between U.S. large caps and these other equity asset classes, and then also from where we were 10 years ago. So as we've ascended higher, there's a much less long-term glide path for ascending stock prices, given these gaps and given the opportunity set between U.S. large caps and these other equity asset classes. Okay, so this is just another historical look. And instead of future earnings, this time we're going to use trailing 12-month earnings, so actual earnings over the last 12 months. And this is interesting on multiple fronts. So again, this is the S&P. And one thing I want to point out on this is PE ratios can go down even though stock prices have gone up. So the S&P is up roughly 20% this year, but US large cap stocks have actually gotten cheaper as earnings have caught up to price. So earnings over the past several quarters have really ascended higher as we get back to normal or on the path to getting back to normal. So that's one thing. The other thing is there's this crowd that perpetually says that stocks are overvalued and they're rich, which is true. But stocks have been technically overvalued since 2016. So this dotted dark blue dotted line is the 10-year average trailing 12-month PE ratio. Okay. And the higher we go, the more expensive stocks get. And anything over this dark blue dotted line is technically rich or overvalued. And we've spent the last almost 6 years now above these lines. So I think that the valuation narrative, you have to pay attention to, but valuation is a terrible timing tool. And as we can see, stocks can be overvalued and still go much higher. And stocks can go up and get cheaper. So it's not a linear relationship. We're not solving math equations. There's nuance to everything. Almost done here, so bear with me. You know, the last couple slides I want to point out is people pay attention to the stock market. That's great. We tend to pay more attention to the bond market. And one of the areas that we pay attention to is credit spread, right? So essentially the cost for corporations, for companies to borrow above the risk-free rate. Okay. So what we're looking at now is this dark blue line is the cost for, let's say, the average credit quality company to borrow funds. And the red line is when the S&P experiences a bear market. A bear market is when the S&P or any market is down by 20% or more. Okay. So what we care about here is spikes. So if the cost of borrowing goes up, that signals stress in the credit markets, stress in the corporate borrowing and lending markets. As you get these spikes, it signals periods of stress and oftentimes is accompanied by a bear market. So what we're looking at is our funding markets, our corporate funding markets experiencing stress? And the answer today is no, but that can change quickly. And I'll just give you a quick example. So this was lower quality companies during the apex of COVID. And you can see borrowing costs and stress really shot up in these markets. And again, that corresponded to a massive sell-off in equity. So this is what we're watching. When these credit spreads start to tick higher, that is one of our rules. That's one of our inputs to potentially taking risk off the table in equities. And this is another theme based upon that. So this, again, this graph is terrible. We tried to make it a little more clear and we couldn't do it. So this is tracking yield curve inversions. So when this dark blue line falls below this kind of grayish line, that means the yield curve is inverted. In other words, short-term yields are higher than long-term yields, which does historically signal signs of stress and does historically act as a precursor to a recession. So these dark gray columns, if you will, are recessions. You can see most every recession since 1962 was preempted by a yield curve inversion here, 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 and again in the COVID sell-off. Now, you can argue that because the yield curve inverted in 2020, that's not why we had a recession. We had a recession because of the global pandemic. So take this with a grain of salt. It's not always clean from a cause and effect standpoint, but there is some rhyme here with yield curve inversions and economic and financial market disruption. You can see right now we're not close to a yield curve inversion, so that's a positive sign. Lastly, I just threw this in here. It kind of lacks context, but you know, we've had a lot of conversations about people being worried about capital gains and the impact on the financial markets and politics on the impact in financial markets. And look, we've beat a dead horse here, but there's no empirical evidence to suggest who's in the White House, who's in Congress, what capital gains taxes are from year to year has an impact on stock prices. So it's good for conversation. It's good to talk at the water cooler, or talk with your buddies on the golf course about who's in office and what you think that means. But financial markets are a complex system. There's millions of variables that are ever changing. Whoever's in the White House, whoever is in Congress, has a minuscule impact on what happens in a complex system. So I say this not to dissuade you from talking about it, but just don't let it leak into your investment strategy. I've seen more catastrophic mistakes made from mixing investing in politics than I ever have in my career, you know, over the last couple of years. So thanks for paying attention. If you made it this far, congratulations. I hope this was thought-provoking. I hope you learned something. Feel free to give us your feedback. Again, we're doing this in place of my written commentary, but if you have any feedback or want to see anything in the future, then let us know. We'll try to weave it into our next video. Thanks and have a wonderful holiday season.